"Fear, Mr. Holmes, it is terror." These words were enough to challenge the master detective, Sherlock Holmes, to an immediate investigation, some rapid deductions, and a brilliant solution. The Adventure of the Speckled Band by Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. On glancing over my notes at the 70-odd cases in which I have, during the last 8 years, studied the methods of my friend Sherlock Holmes, I find none which presented more singular features than that which was associated with the well-known family of the Roylets of Stoke Moran. See, there's a number one, so let's check what that says. Stoke Moran, the name of the Roylet estate. Okay. The events in question occurred in the early days of my association with Holmes, when we were sharing rooms as bachelors in Baker Street. There's number two. Baker Street, Holmes' number on this actual London street was 22. I'm sorry, 221B. It was early in April in the year 83 that I woke one morning to find Sherlock Holmes standing fully dressed by the side of my bed. He was a late riser as a rule, and as the clock showed me that it was only 7:15, I blinked up at him in some surprise, and perhaps just a little resentment, for I was myself regular in my habits. "Very sorry to rouse you up, Watson," he said. "What is it?" "Then, a fire?" I asked. "No, a client. It seems that a young lady has arrived in a considerable state of excitement, who insists upon seeing me. She is waiting now in the sitting room. Now, when young ladies wandered about the metropolis at this hour of morning, I presume that it is something very pressing which they have to communicate. Should it prove to be an interesting case, you would, I am sure, wish to follow it from the outset. I thought at any rate that I should give you the chance." "My dear fellow, I would not miss it for anything." I had no keener pleasure than in following Holmes in his professional investigations, and in admiring the rapid deductions as swift as intuitions. That's a three. Admiring the rapid deductions as swift as intuitions, Dr. Watson admires Holmes' ability to think through a problem quickly and draw a correct conclusion. Holmes could do this as speedily as those who get flashes of truth without stopping to reason at all. Found it on a logical basis with which he unraveled the problems which were submitted to him. I rapidly threw on my clothes and accompanied my friend down to the sitting room. A lady dressed in black and heavily veiled, who had been sitting in the window, rose as we entered. "Good morning, madame," said Holmes cheerily. "My name is Sherlock Holmes. This is my intimate friend and associate, Dr. Watson, before whom you can speak as freely as before myself. I am glad to see that my housekeeper, Mrs. Hudson, has had the good sense to light the fire. Pray draw up to it, and I shall order you a cup of hot coffee, for I observe that you are shivering." "It is not cold which makes me shiver," said the woman in a low voice, changing her seat as requested. "What then?" "It is fear, Mr. Holmes. It is terror." She had raised her veil, and we could see that she was indeed in a pitiable state of agitation, her face all drawn and gray, with restless, frightened eyes, like those of some hunted animal. Her features and her figure were those of a woman of 30, but her hair was shot with premature gray, and her expression was weary and haggard. Sherlock Holmes ran her over with one of his quick, all comprehensive glances. "You must not fear," said he soothingly. "We shall set matters right. I have no doubt you have come in by train this morning, I see." "You know me then?" "No, but I observed the second half of a return ticket in the palm of your left glove. You must have started early, and did you have a good drive in a dog cart along heavy roads before you reached the station?" start and start, stared in bewilderment at my companion. "There is no mystery, my dear madam," he said, smiling. "The left arm of your jacket is spattered with mud in no less than 7 places. The marks are perfectly fresh. There is no vehicle save a dog cart, which throws up mud in that way. And then only when you sit on the left-hand side of the driver. Whatever your reasons may be, you are perfectly correct," she said. "I started from home before 6, reached the railway station at Leatherhead at 20 past, and came in by the first train to Waterloo. Sir, I can stand this strain no longer. I shall go mad if it continues. I have no one to turn to, none, save only one who cares for me, and he, poor fellow, can be of little aid. I have heard of you, Mr. Holmes, from Mrs. Farrington, who you helped in the hour of her sore need. It was from her that I had your address. Oh, sir, do not think that you could help me to, and at least throw a little light through the dense darkness which surrounds me. At present, it is out of my power to reward you for your services. But in a month or 6 weeks, I shall be married, with the control of my own income, and then, at least, you shall not find me ungrateful." Holmes turned to his desk and drew out a small casebook, which he consulted. "I can only say, madam, that I shall be happy to devote the same care to your case as I did to that of your friend. As to reward my profession, is its own reward, but you are at liberty to defray whatever expenses I may be put to, at the time which suits you best. And now I beg you will lay upon us everything that may help us in informing an opinion upon the matter." "My name is Helen Stoner," replied the visitor, "and I am living with my stepfather, who is the last survivor of one of the oldest Saxon families in England, the Roylotts of Stoke Moran in Surrey." Holmes nodded his head. "The name is familiar to me," said he. "The family was at one time among the richest in England, and the estates extended many miles in the last century. However, 4 successive heirs were of a dissolute and wasteful disposition, and the family ruin was eventually completed by a gambler in the days of the Regency. Nothing was left save a few acres of ground and the 200-year-old house, which is itself crushed under a heavy mortgage. The last squire dragged out his existence there, living the horrible life of an aristocrat pauper. But his only son, my stepfather, seeing that he must adapt himself to the new conditions, obtained an advance from a relative, which enabled him to take a medical degree, and went out to Calcutta, where by his professional skill and his force of character, he established a large practice. In a fit of anger, however, caused by some robberies which had been perpetrated in the house, he beat his native butler to death, and narrowly escaped a capital sentence. As it was, he suffered a long term of imprisonment, and afterward returned to England a morose and disappointed man. When Dr. Roylott was in India, he married my mother, Mrs. Stoner, the young widow of Major General Stoner of the Bengal Artillery. My sister Julie and I were twins, and we were only 2 years old at the time of my mother's remarriage. She had a considerable sum of money, not less than £1,000 a year, and this she bequeathed to Dr. Roylott entirely while we resided with him, with a provision that a certain annual sum should be allowed to each of us in the event of our marriage. Shortly after her return to England, my mother died. She was killed 8 years ago in a railway accident. Dr. Roylott then abandoned his attempts to establish himself in practice in London, and took us to live with him in the old ancestral house at Stoke Moran. The money which my mother had left was enough for all our wants, and there seems to be no obstacle to our happiness. But a terrible change came over our stepfather about this time. Instead of making friends and exchanging visits with our neighbors, who had at first been overjoyed to see a Roylott of Stoke Moran back in the house, stepfather's case, it had, I believe, been intensified by his long residence in the tropics. A series of his disgraceful brawls took place, two of which ended in the police court, until at least he became the terror of the village, and the folks would fly at his approach, for he is a man of immense strength and is absolutely uncontrollable in his anger. Last week, it was only by praying over all the money which I could gather together that I was able to avert another police exposure. He had no friends at all save the wandering gypsies, and he would give those vagabonds leave to encamp upon the few acres of bramble-covered land which represent the family estate, and would accept in return the hospitality of their tents, wandering away with them sometimes for weeks on end. He has a passion also for Indian animals, which are sent to him by a correspondent, and he has at this moment a cheetah and a baboon, which wander freely over his grounds and are feared by the villagers almost as much as their master. You can imagine from what I say that my poor sister Julia and I had no great pleasure in our lives. No servant would stay with us, and for a long time we did all the work of the house. Julia was but 30 at the time of her death, and yet her hair had already begun to whiten, even as mine has. Your sister is dead, then. She died just 2 years ago, and it is of her death that I wish to speak to you. You can understand that living the life which I have described, we were little likely to see anyone of our own age and position. However, an aunt, my mother's maiden sister, Mrs. Honoria Westvale, who lives near Harrow, and we were occasionally allowed to pay short visits at this lady's house. Julie went there at Christmas 2 years ago and met there a major of Marines to whom she became engaged. My stepfather learned of the engagement when my sister returned and offered no objection to the marriage, but within a fortnight of the day which had been fixed for the wedding, the terrible event occurred, which has deprived me of my only companion. Sherlock Holmes had been leaning back in his chair with his eyes closed and his head sunk in a cushion, but he half opened his lids now and glanced across his visitor. "Pray be precise as to the details," said he. "It is easy for me to be so, for every event at that dreadful time is seared into my memory. The manor house is, as I have already said, very old, and only one wing is now inhabited. The bedrooms in this wing are on the ground floor, the sitting rooms being in the central block of the buildings. Of these bedrooms, the first is Dr. Roylet's, the second my sister's, and the third my own. There is no communication between them, but they all open out into the same corridor. Do I make myself plain?" "Perfectly so." "The windows of the three rooms are full length and open out upon the lawn. That fatal night, Dr. Roylet had gone to his room early, though he knew that he had not retired to rest, for my sister was troubled by the smell of the strong Indian cigars, which it was his custom to smoke. She left her room, therefore, and came into mine, where she sat for some time, chatting about her approaching wedding. At 11 o'clock, she rose to leave me, but she paused at the door and looked back. 'Tell me, Ellen,' she said, 'have you ever heard anyone whistle in the dead of the night?' 'Never,' I said. 'I suppose that you could not possibly whistle yourself in your sleep.' 'Certainly not. But why?' 'Because during the last few nights, I have always, about 3 in the morning, heard a low, clear whistle. I am a light sleeper, and it has awakened me. I could not tell where it came from, perhaps from the next room, perhaps from the lawn. I thought that I would just ask you whether you had heard it.' 'No, I have not.' 'It must be those wretched gypsies in the plantation.' 'Very likely. And yet if it were on the lawn, I wonder that you did not hear it also.' 'Ah, but I sleep more heavily than you.' 'Well, it is of no great consequence at any rate.' She smiled back at me and closed my door. And a few moments later, I heard her key turn in the lock of her own door." "Indeed," said Holmes. "Was it your proceed with your statement. I could not sleep that night. A vague feeling of impending misfortune impressed me. My sister and I, you will recollect, were twins, and you know how subtle are the links which bind two souls which are so closely allied. It was a wild night. The wind was howling outside, and the rain was beating and splashing against the windows. Suddenly, amid all of the hubbub of the gale, there burst forth the wild scream of a terrified woman. I knew that it was my sister's voice. I sprang from my bed, wrapped a shawl around me, and rushed into the corridor. As I opened my door, I seemed to hear a low whistle, such as my sister described, and a few moments later, a changing sound, as if a mass of metal had fallen. As I ran down the passage, my sister's door was unlocked, and I revolved slowly upon its hinges. I stared at it, horror-stricken, not knowing what was about to issue from it. By the light of the corridor lamp, I saw my sister appear at the opening, her face blanched with terror, her hands groping for help, her whole figure swaying to and fro like that of a drunkard. I ran to her and threw my arms around her, but at that moment her knees seemed to give away, and she fell to the ground. She writhed as one who is in terrible pain, and her limbs were dreadfully convulsed. At first, I thought that she had not recognized me, but as I bent over her, she suddenly shrieked out in my voice, in a voice which I shall never forget, "Oh, my God, Helen, it was the band, the speckled band." There was something else which she would fain had said, and she stabbed with her finger into the air in the direction of the doctor's room. But a fresh convulsion seized her and choked her words. I rushed out, calling loudly for my stepfather, and I met him, hastening from his room in his dressing gown. When he reached my sister's side, she was unconscious, and though he poured brandy down her throat and sent for medical aid from the village, all efforts were in vain, for she slowly sank and died without having recovered her consciousness. Such was the dreadful end of my beloved sister. "One moment," said Holmes. "Are you sure about this whistle and the metallic sound? Could you swear to it?" "That was what the county coroner asked me at the inquiry. It is my strong impression that I heard it. And yet, among the crash of the gale and the creaking of an old house, I may possibly have been deceived." "Was your sister dressed?" "No, she was in her nightdress. In her right hand was found the charred stump of a match, and in her left a matchbox, showing that she had struck a light and looked about her when the alarm took place." "That is important. And what conclusions did the coroner come to?" "He investigated the case with great care, for Dr. Roylott's conduct had long been notorious in the county, but he was unable to find any satisfactory bedroom wall has been pierced so that I have had to move into the chamber in which my twin sister died and to sleep in the very bed in which she slept. Imagine my thrill of terror when last night, as I lay awake thinking over her terrible fate, I suddenly heard in the silence of the night the low whistle which had been the herald of her own death. I sprang up and lit the lamp, but nothing was to be seen in the room. I was too shaken to go to bed again, however, so I dressed, and as soon as it was daylight, I slipped down, got a dog cart at the Crown Inn, which is opposite, and drove to Leatherhead, from whence I have come home this morning, with the one object of seeing you and asking your advice. You have done wisely, said my friend, but have you told me all? Yes, all. Miss Stoner, you have not. You are screening your stepfather. What do you mean? For an answer, Holmes pushed back to the frill of black lace which fringed the hand that lay upon our visitor's knee. Five little livid spots, the marks of our fingers and a thumb, were printed upon the white wrist. You have been cruelly used, said Holmes. The lady colored deeply and covered over her injured wrist. He is a hard man, she said, and perhaps he hardly knows his own strength. There was a long silence, during which Holmes leaned his chin upon his hands and stared into the crackling fire. This is a very deep business, he said at last. There are a thousand details which I should desire to know before I decide upon our course of action. Yet we have not a moment to lose. If we were to come to Stockmoran today, would it be possible for us to see over these rooms without the knowledge of your stepfather? As it happens, he spoke of coming into town today upon some most important business. It is probable that he will be away all day and that there would be nothing to disturb you. We have a housekeeper now, but she is old and foolish, and I could easily get her out of the way. Excellent. You are not averse to this trip, Watson. By no means. Then we shall both come. What are you going to do yourself? I have one or two things which I could wish to do now that I am in town, but I shall return by the 12 o'clock train, so as to be there in time for your coming. And you may expect us early in the afternoon. I have some small business matters to attend to. Will you not wait and breakfast? No, I must go. My heart is lighted already, since I have confided my trouble to you. I shall look forward to seeing you again this afternoon. She dropped her thick black veil over her face and glided from the room. And what do you think of it all, Watson? Asked Holmes after seeing her out. It seems to be a most dark and sinister business. Dark enough and sinister enough. Yet if the lady is correct in saying that the flooring and walls are sound and that the door, window, and chimney are impassable, then her sister must have been undoubtedly alone when she met her mysterious end. What becomes, then, of these nocturnal whistles, and what of the very, very peculiar words of the dying woman? I cannot think. When you combine the ideas of whistles at night, the presence of a band of gypsies who are on intimate terms with this old doctor, the fact that we have every reason to believe that the doctor has an interest in preventing his stepdaughter's marriage, the dying allusion to a band, and finally the fact that Miss Ellen Stoner heard a metallic clang which might have been caused by one of those metal bars which secured the shutters falling back into its place. I think that there is a good ground to think that the mystery may be cleared along those lines. But what then did the gypsies do? I cannot imagine. I see many objections to any such theory, and so do I. It is precisely for that reason that we are going to Stockmoran this day. I want to see whether the objections are fatal or if they may be explained away. But what in the name of the devil? The ejaculation had been drawn from my companion by the fact that our door had been suddenly dashed open and that a huge man had framed himself to the aperture. His costume was a peculiar mix of the professional and of the agricultural, having a black top hat, a long frock coat, the sun and marked with every evil passion was turned from one to the other of us, while his deep-set eyes and his high, thin, fleshless nose gave him somewhat the resemblance to a fierce old bird of prey. "Which of you is Holmes?" asked his apparition. "My name, sir, but you have advantage of me," said my companion quietly. "I am Dr. Grimsby Roylott of Stoke Moran." "Indeed, doctor," said Holmes blandly, "pray take a seat." "I will do nothing of the kind. My stepdaughter has been here. I have traced her. What has she been saying to you?"
"It is a little cold for the time of the year," said Holmes.
"What has she been saying to you?" screamed the old man furiously. "But I've heard that the crocuses promise well," continued my companion imperturbably.
"Ah, you put me off to you," said our new visitor, taking a step forward and shaking his hunting crop.
"I know you, you scoundrel. I have heard of you before. You are Holmes, the meddler." My friend smiled. "Holmes, the busybody." "Jack in office." Holmes chuckled heartily. "Your conversation is most entertaining," said he. "When you go out, close the door, for there is a second draft. I will go when I have said my say. Don't you dare to meddle with my affairs. I know that Miss Stoner has been here. I traced her. I am a dangerous man to fall foul of. See here." He stepped forward, seized the poker, and bent it into a curve with his huge brown hand. "See that you keep yourself out of my grip," he snarled, and hurling the twisted poker into the fireplace, he strode out of the room. "He seems a very amiable person," said Holmes, laughing. "I'm not quite so bulky, but if I had remained, I might have shown him that my grip was not much more feeble than his own." As he spoke, he picked up the steel poker and with a sudden effort, straightened it out. "Fancy his having the insolence to found me with the official detective force. This incident gives zest to our investigation, however, and I only trust that our prudence in allowing this brute to trace her. And now, Watson, we shall order breakfast, and afterward I shall walk down to Doctor's Commons, where I hope to get some data which may help us in this matter."